welcome to episode 483 of Cinematary. I'm your host, Zach Dennis, and I'm here with
Grace Winburn
and Andrew Swafford in person, live.
In person, live from the Toronto International Film Festival, from our lovely Airbnb here off of DuPont Street.
Should we tell them where it, like...
Can we, like, leave a five-star review of this Airbnb on the podcast? This is easily the greatest Airbnb I've ever stayed in.
Yeah, let's just... we can send it to the host and just say, like, we give you a review of the Airbnb on the podcast. Because, no, it's fantastic. Like, we've got, like, everybody's got their own room. Everybody's got their own bathroom. Like, there's got a piano here. We got a lovely kitchen and everything. There's an upstairs. It's gorgeous.
Impeccable taste in books. Throughout all of the shelves.
Yeah, no
TV. This house.
No TV here, just books.
Yeah. Not a cell phone in sight.
Exactly. We're going to talk about TIFF and what we've seen here in part one, and then in part two, I'm ditching Grace and Andrew and talking to Nadine and Reed about broadcast news.
Yeah. Welcome back, Nadine and Reed, to the pod.
Yeah, for our journalism and film series. But let's go ahead and jump into TIFF, because we got a bunch of stuff we're going to cover in not a lot of time. Let's go. So we saw four films together. We're going to go over three of them that I feel like are probably ones on people's lists.
I think so. Movies that already are kind of like have buzz around them.
Yeah, one has already won an award. So let's go ahead. Let's just jump into there.
Yeah.
Let's start.
This won the award. Like, going into this festival, I feel like this was the most hyped movie just because it won the Palme d'Or at Cannes.
Yeah, so the Palme d'Or winner, Anora, which is the latest from Sean Baker, who did Tangerine, Florida Project, Red Rocket, has kind of become a A24 stalwart, but now, I guess, is working for Neon, which, forgive me for tagging A24 after his last three movies were with A24.
It's so funny to me that you... attributed the movie to A24, but Neon retweeted my tweet about the movie.
Yeah, Neon is like
they saw your slight.
Yeah, we're pro Cinematary because of that. A24 has not returned our calls. Anora, it stars Mikey Madison. She plays Anora, who is a young
Ani.
Huh?
Ani. She insists
Ani.
Her name is Ani,
but Anora is prettier. She plays a young exotic dancer, lives in Brooklyn. One night in the club that she works at, a young son of a Russian oligarch comes in.
Yeah. Is this a real Russian oligarch, by the way?
I didn't
look it up.
I don't know. He was in the movie, so that would be kind of interesting if he was. So this son of a Russian oligarch comes in. He's looking for a girl who can speak Russian to, you know, can conversate with him in Russian. They seem to really hit it off. She, you know, meets up with him at his place a couple times. They kind of spark this somewhat of a relationship to a degree.
It's like a transactional relationship that, you know, feels like there's genuine chemistry to it.
Yeah,
to a certain extent, right?
But spur of the moment, they're in Vegas and they get married. And then news of that marriage reaches his family back in Russia, and they aren't thrilled.
They are comedically not thrilled.
Let's start with you, Andrew. I know we all saw this at a P&I screening. I know we'll get to Grace in a second because she's not seen a Sean Baker film, but as somebody who's seen a couple of Sean Baker's works, what did you think of this one?
I've seen two. I've seen Tangerine. That was my introduction back when Public Cinema showed it in Knoxville several years ago. Absolutely loved that movie. And liked the Florida Project as well to a somewhat lesser extent, but I do like the big formal move that it makes in the very end that a lot of people were kind of debating at the time it came out.
And I like really a great Willem Dafoe performance.
A great Willem Dafoe performance, absolutely. I think that one of the strengths of Sean Baker's is his work with actors. Like, he is kind of known for working with a lot of unknown people and people whose lives kind of resemble what you're seeing them portray on screen, and always does so with like a great deal of care and empathy and like. I don't know, considerateness, if that is the word. Consideration for, like, the dignity of this person who many people would probably laugh at for one reason or another, right? Mm-hmm. Um, or looked down upon. People who are kind of like living in the margins of society.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, like I really appreciated his work with Mikey Madison. That's her name in this movie. She is a fantastic performance. And I love the vibe of this movie, the way that it moves. It's one of those movies where the whole first half of it feels like this music video. You know, it is all done in montage. It's all done with needle drops. When you see things like Ani at her job, you're never seeing like scenes of her at her job. You're getting like these brief snapshots of like little petty indignities or, you know, what is the kind of minute by minute existence of this job in kind of like fast forward almost.
Mm-hmm.
So the movie has a great deal of energy to it. And then that energy shifts quite abruptly in the second half when it becomes much more of an out-and-out comedy. As, like, Ani has been essentially kidnapped by the Russian mob and is like, on this rampage to track down her lover, which is a trope that we're familiar with from Tangerine. Mm-hmm. Sean Baker, he does that, again, here extremely well. And I don't know if I want to say all that much more about it, but I thought that it just totally succeeds on all the levels that it's going for, which is quite a few.
I thought your little capsule review of it that we put on Twitter and Instagram was kind of a good sell of, you know, fans of Tangerine, you'll like this, but then also if you're also a fan of the recent Safdie Brothers movies,
yes.
Yeah.
You'll really like this because it kind of has a coexisting energy there.
I think that the Safdies and Sean Baker both have a similar sense of humor in that, like, they are creating comedic situations out of people being really stressed out and angry with each other. That you, the audience, you're not looking down upon these people because he's always portraying them in a very empathetic way, but from our critical distance is kind of absurdly funny. So the just extreme stress and violence of the last half of this movie is just like quite a ride, I think.
Mm-hmm.
But Chris, yeah. What are your thoughts about it?
So like Zach said earlier, this is my first Sean Baker, and walking out of the theater, I overheard someone, and I wish that I could get their name so I could properly quote them, but they said he's a deeply humanist director.
Yes.
And I, now from what I'm hearing from Andrew about Tangerine and Florida Project, from what I saw with my own two eyes, I would agree with that. There is a real care and tenderness. What devolves into this comedy of errors, looking for, you know, someone who's lost, it's through everyone's quirks and idiosyncrasies that they're able to even, you know, try and attempt to find this person. And you really get a sense of who these people are. There's so much more than, you know, never judge a book by its cover, but there's so much more. Like, Ani is so much more than a exotic dancer, a sex worker. They assign these harsh and cruel labels to her in an attempt to demean her and maybe dull her sparkle or, you know, lessen her bright. And they just can't because her spirit really shines through. And over the course of the film, everybody's personalities and are really explored and poked and are not poked fun at, but
I mean, they all are mined for comedy.
Yes.
But like never in a way that I feel like is meant to like diminish their humanity, if that makes sense.
Yeah, definitely. They do a really good job of you know, not of kind of like taking down like some small stereotypes and judgments between characters, like, and each other.
They roast each other a lot.
They roast each other a lot, but then they also like learn about each other a lot, and there's an interesting dynamic that grows from that. This is also, you know, rich people treating, you know, regular people as accessories and toys to play with and bust up, and this also does a lot of, you know, when the lights come on in the party, you know, what happens and you're in the cold, hard light of day, like, you have to examine your choices. Mm-hmm. And suffer the consequences of those, whether you like it or not. So this was fantastic. Really, really enjoyable. Absolutely beautiful.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. No, I mean, this one was probably my favorite of the festival that I saw. I really liked it. I wasn't a giant fan of Red Rocket, which is his third movie after Tangerine and Florida Project. This definitely, I agree, like, has that Tangerine energy to it of just, mm-hmm. like...
Propulsive.
Yeah, it's very... Right. It's just you're... Especially once you get to the part where the Russians have got there and they're like, hey, we got to get rid of this marriage. It becomes very propulsive and just, like, you know... you have that same energy of, like, in that movie where you're running around Los Angeles. Like, this one, it's running around... New York, and they're almost treating New York like it's a small city, like a small town.
Yeah.
Like
they're just walking from bar to bar, holding up an iPhone and like showing a picture of this guy. Have you seen this child? He's very sick. We need to find him.
Yeah, and that just like on its face is really entertaining to me because it's just like a very. This isn't like you know some small Midwestern town. It's like it's New York City, and they're treating it like it's.
Wait, they're not in New York City, are they? Because aren't they somewhere out west near Vegas?
No, they're in New York, like, when they're looking.
Yeah.
Like, they're going all throughout, but they've gone to Coney Island. They're tracking him on his behavior, and they're various... Maybe I should stop saying so much, but, like...
Yeah, we should leave a little...
Yeah, we should leave a little...
Mystery.
Yeah.
But, yeah, no, it's... if you're a fan of Tangerine or Florida Project, if you're kind of curious about this movie after it won at Cannes, like, it holds up, at least for me. Like, definitely check it out. It'll be... Like we said, it's a neon release, so it'll get a real wide berth.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Cool. Andrew, do you want to introduce Bird for us?
I would like to introduce Bird. Bird is a movie by Andrea Arnold. People will probably most know her from American Honey.
Yeah.
Before that, she made a great movie called Fish Tank, which was my favorite of hers, probably before this one, to spoil my review of Bird.
Super good movie.
And then also, she made an older movie called Red Road. She made an adaptation of Wuthering Heights. And she also, I tried to watch her most recent movie, Cow, before Bird. And I got about 15 minutes into it, and I thought, like, I cannot, this is not an experience that I'm ready for emotionally at this very moment. That is, like, just, from what I can tell, a very... unflinching day in the life or like story of the life of a cow in like a factory farm wasn't up for that experience. But Bird she's telling a coming of age story again, kind of similar to Fish Tank. The relationship between this movie and Fish Tank reminds me a little of like the relationship between Anora and Tangerine for Sean Baker. It feels like she's making one of her previous movies again, but way better this time because she like just is a more experienced filmmaker, has like more access and more. I mean, I don't want to speculate on like what Andrea Arnold's professional career arc has been, but
well, you have two big name actors.
Yeah, big stars in this movie. Yeah. Anyways, this is a coming of age tale about this young girl ? There's some gender identity stuff going on in this movie. She is the daughter of Barry Keoghan, who kind of like launches into this movie full speed a couple of minutes into it.
He sure does. And it never stops.
Barry Keoghan, I admire Barry Keoghan for like always finding a new kind of weird guy to be.
He does.
And one of my favorite Barry Keoghan weird guys.
We were talking about weird guys, Barry Keoghan. I also thought of his weird guy performance in The Green Knight when he just up and it's just like full weird guy mode. This is, if you like that energy, he's here again.
Yeah. Here he's like bumbling / abusive dad.
Yeah.
Who like became a dad way too young and has way too many kids with way too many women and is just like, his life is not stable in a way that like, nobody's life in this movie is stable. I think that's part of what Andrea Arnold is so good at capturing in this movie and American Honey and Fish Tank. Like, people whose lives are not, like, don't sit still because of, like, how much they are living on the edge in terms of, like, needing to have food to survive and, like, living in dangerous neighborhoods where, like, they're... physical bodies are threatened, on a fairly regular basis, whether it's due to like domestic abuse at home or gang violence or whatever. But anyways, this is you know, a story of a young girl coming growing up in that environment, and she loves cinema. She the first thing we see her doing is, I think, filming birds in the air, and then one of them comes in, like just hangs out next to her for a little while. This little seagull she has a moment with. Andrea Arnold is also really great at like incorporating animals into her work and having characters have like meaningful interactions with animals.
I just want to say for the listeners, at that point, Andrew leaned over to me and said, "That's Bird." and by the way, that wasn't Bird.
That wasn't the Bird. There's a person named Bird, if you can believe it, and even better than that being Bird.
Yeah.
But she, what this girl does, just for fun, is captures small bits of beauty that she comes across in her phone, and then like she has a projector screen in her room that she just like connects to her phone and like loops and relives these moments. But she also uses cinema like to, I don't know, attain a certain degree of power in her world as well, because she realizes that having video footage of something happening is indisputable proof that the thing happened, which can then kind of like give you leverage in like social, family, neighborhood dynamics. And so I think that this movie is really interesting in the way that it is kind of like demonstrating, I don't know, the way that people use cinema on a daily or more like grounded basis, that cinema has like uses, you know, if that makes sense. But to be honest, the thing that really sells this movie for me is the soundscape of it. Andrea Arnold, it has such great use of music throughout her filmography. She has so many great moments in earlier movies where characters listen to songs in full, and the scene is kind of like given in a certain identity because of the presence of that song. And so she has a very wide array of sounds here. Like there are many more musical moments in this than in her previous movies. It's so much more like packed with sound. Mm-hmm. And part of that is due to the contributions of a composer that I am extremely fond of. I'm going to try not to talk about too much on this podcast, but Burial, my favorite electronic producer, did the score for this movie. He's never done a score before other than another movie coming out this year called Baby Invasion by Harmony Korine. But he makes a pretty wide array of sounds, like ranging. He started making like really skeletal dance music, and has kind of like drifted in between clubby dance music and like textural ambient music for the past couple of decades, or I guess decade plus at this point. But there are just like such a like a rich textured soundscape throughout this entire movie, both in like the world the characters are inhabiting and the music that is they're kind of like living within. And it's a really great movie in terms of capturing the communal power of music and how people like use music to lift themselves and other people up.
I was waiting for you to like, I thought your music thing was going to be about Yellow by Coldplay. Which
well,
also...
we need to talk about The Toad. We really cannot not talk about The Toad. Barry Keoghan's whole deal is he has a get-rich-quick scheme, which is that he... Apparently there's some toad that lives out in Colorado that secretes a psychedelic liquid, and now he's got it, and he's just going to, like, you know, milk this toad for LSD or whatever. But... the only way, or the best way to do this, apparently, is to play the toad sincere music. any music that has any degree of irony or detachment to it, the toad will not slime to. But Yellow by Coldplay will do the trick. Absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah. There's, like, if you're kind of like, how big of a role is the toad going to have? The toad, Barry Keoghan's constantly talking about the toad.
Yeah, I mean, and it's really unpredictable when Barry Keoghan is going to barrel into the scene and begin talking about the toad. It's always a welcome.
Barrel is a good verb because he is getting places on an electric scooter that I feel like by the end of the movie can fit 20 people on it. But he's
is going way too fast down those streets.
Way too fast.
No safety gear.
But Grace, what did you think of Bird?
I really latched on to the family dynamics. And trying to figure them out as they were so complicated and there was so much going on and a lot of different generations happening all at once and age gaps in siblings and half-siblingness and trying to grow up that and, you know, where they fit in these parental roles. It was very overwhelming and it was very upsetting. And hard to keep up with, and then I can't imagine living that. But Bailey finds, you know, some peace in it all, and she has such a big heart, and she does take on role of big sister and caregiver to her mother's daughters, to her half sisters, or are they her whole? They're her.
I don't know if she has any full siblings.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. I think then they're half. But they're all so beautiful, and they all just can't help what they were born into. This this unstable house, these volatile homes, all they want to do is just be children and thrive and be themselves. We mentioned the uncertain gender roles with Bailey. Mm. There's some question about, bless you, there's some question about, or a big argument about her hair, as Bailey is a mixed young girl, and like what her hair represents, and then how she shaves down her afro to more of like a sort of a boy's haircut, and it sort of
and
seems,
then immediately goes to hang out with the boys.
And then immediately goes to hang out with the boys while also having interesting crushes and relationships on some of the boys that her half brother hangs out with.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's that in this world, the men really are the force and the power, and then all these women are relegated to this role of like subservience and and having the children and like putting up with the volatile men who like.
Yeah.
Cannot help being so volatile and unstable given their, you know, status in this world. So,
and part of why I put like a question mark on the she here is that like it's a little unclear whether or not this character doesn't identify as a girl or if she kind of wants to embody the role that men have in our society, which is just to be a little bit more commanding of a space, you know?
Yeah, she's very like. She's very taken in by one of her half brothers who lives with them seems to be like taking up with a gang who is going around like beating people up who they view themselves as like vigilantes like going and beating up bad people and Bailey seems very like taken by a role in that.
She like alerts them. She's the surveillance system that then that then alerts the enforcers to the wrongdoing, and that's kind of interesting, but I think, you know, she's pretty righteous in her pursuit. It is bad people by definition, I would say, but, you know.
And also, like, regarding gender things in the movie, we should probably talk about the other star of the movie, aside from Barry Keoghan, which is Franz Rogowski.
Yeah.
People probably know him from various movies by Christian Petzold, Transit, Undine, I think is how you say that movie.
Yeah.
He was also in Terrence Malick's A Hidden Life.
Yeah,
he was very great in that.
Probably people remember him, though, from last year with Passages, which he starred in with Ben Whishaw.
But he is here playing the titular Bird, who
is
a boy, who, like, has a very mysterious past.
Kind of a drifter.
Wears gender nonconforming clothes, is wearing a skirt when we meet him, there's also some magical realism going on with his character that is like a really fun new layer to like what Andrea Arnold does. But anyways, we probably talked about this one too long, but I think that we can all agree that it's really
Definitely want to check out. I forgot I forgot who's distributing this one, but
I don't know if it has a distributor yet, but
please someone pick it up.
A24 and Neon will get it. It has their names written all over it.
Yeah, 100%. All right, let's wrap up the ones that we all kind of caught with the C of ABC, and that's Cloud, which is the latest Kiyoshi Kurosawa movie.
Grace, do you want to introduce this one?
Yes.
We both introduce.
Sure. I will do my best. Cloud.
Do you want to read the?
Yeah, that would be a lot more succinct for me. Ryosuke Yoshi is an ordinary person who supports himself by reselling things on the internet. He carelessly earns grudges by people around him, and in the end, he is dragged into a desperate struggle that risks his life. So this man, he picks up product at a discount. He picks it off from people, and then turns around and resells it at a great price and makes a fantastic profit off of it. And he has this uncanny knack for it. He has the best luck and makes great work out of it. He also has a factory job that really doesn't speak to him. That's just sort of, you know, extra. And he's got this girlfriend that loves money and always needs more of it.
They love buying things,
they love spending money, and that's like their favorite pastime. That's what they spend all their time doing, is thinking about money, getting money, spending money, getting more money. And he decides to leave his factory job, although he is moving up in it. He's been offered a promotion. He seems to be fantastic at that too. He just seems to be a great worker and great at working whatever system he's involved in. But he doesn't want to work in the factory anymore. He decides to go full-time with his reselling business, goes legit, gets an assistant, and things sort of spiral out of there.
Yeah, this is also one that I feel like we shouldn't say too much about.
Right.
Because it has a great, feels like a genre shift in it.
Yeah.
I guess we could say what the genres are, though. It starts as kind of like a workplace procedural. You're just kind of like watching him make money. Both at his factory job and like reselling stuff on the internet for like as a side hustle. And then by the end of the movie, we're in like a full on crime thriller.
Yeah.
And one thing I really like about the movie is like the gradual ramping up of how illegal things feel. because there's definitely a point in which we are absolutely doing illegal things. We're like killing people and allowing people to be killed. But it's really not clear where the line is crossed, at what point, you know, what action is like the ethical tipping point in this movie. You know, it's just kind of characters following a logical trajectory towards how do I make and secure money.
Well, it's kind of like a commentary on like just dealings on the internet where
you can
Yoshi, like he's just sitting there screwing people over on the internet. That's what generally pisses them off.
Mm-hmm.
But he does it, you know, to him it's just like, oh, you know, he's not looking at them face to face while he's screwing them over. He just,
yes,
you know, it's very everything. We talked about transactions in Anora. This is also a very transactional movie. Like he fucks up people's lives. And like it's a mouse click for him, and he moves on. His bank account is pretty much like a video game.
You gotta get the number up.
It's not like, oh, do I have enough to like pay my rent, pay my bills, get food? It's like I gotta get to this level. Like almost like this video game component.
I need to be able to buy more things.
Yeah, exactly.
And I think that it should also ignore that like Kiyoshi Kurosawa is really good at dealing with and just depicting the internet on screen. He made kind of like one of the first internet horror films with Pulse in 2001, when the internet was still very new and very different, and I feel like he prophesied what the internet would do to us on a societal level better than anybody I can name, especially from that time. And so here there's like a different like angle to the alien presence that is the internet. You're just kind of like watching people stare at their like online inventories as they wait for them to like sell out and for the number to go up, you know. And there, that is absolutely a thing that people do. Just like I'm just like keeping tabs on my investments, or I am just like looking at things that I wish to buy. And so just, much of the internet is like, would you like to look at things that you wish to buy?
Yeah, and it's just so detached from everything, you know. It's, and he gets to this point. I don't think this is super spoilery, but he like gets to this point where he's like, I'm achieving much success. But at the same time, like I'm getting some blowback from people. And he kind of does like the thing that I think people talk about on the internet. It's like, oh, like, you know, too much internet, too much social media, too much stuff. I'm going to like move to the woods.
And he
makes that move. And I think it's the direction it takes is kind of funny, because it's just like, yeah, like, moving to the woods isn't going to save you.
Yeah, you're still
going
on
off
the
grid.
Yeah, if you have an internet account at all, you're on the grid.
Yeah. But no, I think, you know, without saying too much, it really dovetails into something really entertaining that kind of it makes up for the first half of it is very like you said, procedural. Like
it's cold.
You're kind of just like, you're kind of going like, where the hell is this movie gonna go? And then it picks up. Grace, what did you think of Clown?
I enjoyed it. There were some bits I noticed a lot of people were getting some laughs out of it. The humor in there. That's another, you know, maybe genre to add to it, a little bit of humor, a little bit of a supernatural thriller. Like there was definitely like a spooky sort of edge to it.
Mm-hmm.
I liked this. This is definitely one that I'd like to probably catch again, because I feel like there's a lot that I maybe
missed. It seems like it would be a good rewatch movie.
Yeah, absolutely.
When you kind of, especially in like a very quiet space,
oh,
I think.
Yeah.
Like Kyoshi Kurosawa's sound design is amazing in everything that I've seen of his. And he is able, he's mostly known for horror movies, right? And he's able to scare you with silence better than anybody I have ever seen. Like there, he doesn't do it a lot in this movie because it's more of a crime movie than a horror movie, but there's one moment that's like meant to capture like the paranoia that a character is feeling, that he's being watched or being followed or something, where like the audio just drops out for like a second and it's scary as fuck. But he also uses volume. Really, he captures like how loud gunshots are.
Yeah.
More better than any movie I've seen other than like Heat. I was thinking about the ending of Heat in that shootout sequence, and how like intense and aggressive and like just startling every single one of those noises feels. So 10 out of 10 on the sound front for me as well here.
Yeah. I don't know when Cloud will be hitting theaters, but I think also like that's one to definitely put on your list whenever it does come out. I think even, like, I'll be honest, this is the first Kiyoshi Kurosawa movie I've ever seen.
Me too.
Y'all, you need to see Cure.
I'm going
to
see Cure.
Cure is his masterpiece, in my opinion. There's a new criterion of it. It's beautiful.
I'm about to dive into his films after that. We're gonna wrap up. We got about 15 minutes left. Let's do some quick hits from each person on movies that we didn't talk about. I'll go first real quickly. This is kind of the movie that's been talked about a bunch. It just won an award at Venice. It just got bought by A24 for $10 million.
Yeah.
That's The Brutalist, which is the latest from Brady Corbet, who did Confessions of a Dictator and Vox Lux.
I think Childhood of a Leader is the movie you're thinking of. That's Hitler being a very naughty boy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Those are his previous two movies. He's, you know, his acting before. He was in Mysterious Skin. Shout out to that series that we did.
Funny Games.
Yeah.
So good in Funny Games.
But this one is not like any of those.
Yeah.
This one follows Laszlo Toth. He is a Hungarian Jew who has escaped. This takes place post-war. He's survived the Holocaust. He is like going to America now to start a new life and kind of reinvent himself to a degree. His wife and their niece are back in Europe, and the movie pretty much starts, and you have this like pulse. The score in this is fantastic. It just has like this industrial pulse to it. It sounds like pistons turning. Like it just feels like toom, 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 and you have like that going as like Adrian Brody, who plays the lead, he plays Laszlo Toth. He's like maneuvering through the ship, and then you like get out and you just have like the Statue of Liberty as he gets to America. And this follows him. He gets to America. He initially shacks up with his brother-in-law, I think, is the relation. I think it's his wife's brother, who owns a furniture store outside Philadelphia. They, he gets a big commission from this very wealthy, also kind of a son of a very wealthy person who's played by Joe Alwyn, who wants them to redesign their father's study and make it like this lavish, or just make it like a nicer, like kind of a library setting. Mm-hmm. And so you have Laszlo Toth, the Adrian Brody character, who has designed churches and libraries and like all cathedrals, like all these different like synagogues, like all these different like beautiful buildings back in Hungary, in Budapest. And he designs this just gorgeous, very like minimalist modern room. But that's interrupted by Guy Pearce, who plays the very wealthy owner of the house, Harrison Lee Van Buren, who comes in. He's like, "What the hell are y'all doing in my house? Like, you know, you've changed everything." He kind of yells and shouts him out of there. The son ends up calling the brother-in-law back. He's like, "I'm not paying y'all, like, you know, piss off," pretty much. And so the brother-in-law throws Laszlo to the street pretty much and is like, "You got to get out of here." And so then Laszlo's working on, and mind you, this is a 4-hour movie. So this is just touching like the very, like the first 20% of
it. Is it a full 4 hours?
I think it's like 3.5. But okay. I mean, it's a long ass movie with an intermission in the middle of it.
I wonder if the A24 will do the intermissions when they.
Yeah.
Why?
But anyway, so he finds another odd job. He's working construction, and Harrison Lee Van Buren finds him again and is just like, "You know, I'm sorry for my outburst. I didn't know who you were." He like has all this information about Laszlo from back in Budapest, and he's like, "I want you to come to my house and design this." His mother has just died, and he wants to build this like center, this community center that's like in her name. And he's like, I'm putting the whole, like, it's yours. Like, I want you to build it in your vision." And that's pretty much the rest of the movie, is Laszlo kind of trying to realize this vision. It's very much like a, American Dream movie. Adrian Brody is just, this is probably his best work. He's massive for the 3.5+ hour runtime. Guy Pearce is fantastic. Felicity Jones shows up as later in the film as Laszlo's wife, and she's very good in her kind of limited time compared to the others. It'll be interesting to see. I like this movie. I think a lot of there was some big hyperbole about it coming out of Venice.
There's definitely hype.
Yeah,
the line for it was crazy.
Yeah, I don't know if I agree with that. Like, I'm not going like instant classic, like put it in the books. I think it's really good. I think the runtime and just the scope of it, I think immediately calls like, "Hey, we got a like instant classic on our hands."
Yeah,
to people's minds.
It's big and important.
Like, I'm going to call it probably a gazillion times in my reviews of it. Like, it's a 5-course meal of a movie. It's like, you're strap in for this one. But I think it's good. I think it straddles a lot of storylines that you've seen before in terms of people kind of trying to achieve an American dream and just America beating the shit out of them being America. But I think this one does it, the way that Brady Corbet like conveys that and shows that, adds some layers to it. But The Brutalist, like I said, A24 just bought it. I don't know when they're going to be bringing it out. I would assume at some point later this year, because it has all this buzz, it could be an awards favorite. But
I'm guessing we'll get it. Like, it'll be an awards like New York and LA movie in January or December, and then we'll get it in January.
Yeah. Well, again, long runtime, but I don't know. I've been pro super long runtimes. I went and saw Killers of the Flower Moon. I went and saw Horizon, an American Story Saga Part 1. I'm gonna go. I saw The Brutalist. Give me some more 4-hour movies. I'll go see them. Grace.
My favorite and what I was really looking forward to the most, is actually a tie, but one I really want to talk about the most. I saw The Substance. I loved it. I lived for it. It's everything. But the one that I really, that I had the biggest experience with was The Last Showgirl. This is by Gia Coppola. This is also my first Gia Coppola. Something about the Coppola girls, they're really good at tapping into a real tenderness, and they're really great at building at, or at like pulling and showcasing female communities. And this is another one of women supporting women, or just women who only have themselves to turn to. This follows the story of Shelley, played by Pamela Anderson, who is phenomenal. She pours her whole heart and soul into this, and you really feel like this is a very personal and honest portrayal. Shelley is a dancer on the Razzle Dazzle, the Last Showgirl variety show on the Vegas Strip, with the feather boas and the crystals, the gowns, everything. It's a live nudie show, but it is the Razzle Dazzle, the iconic. After her 32 or 3-year run, the show is closing, and she has 2 weeks to try and figure out her next steps. Shelley is this really bubbly, optimistic, kind of ditzy showgirl. She's done it all, she's seen it all, and she has the experience to back it all up. She also dances in this show with Brenda Song as Marianne, and Kiernan Shipka as Julie, I believe is her name.
Yeah.
And those are also young showgirls who are on the same path as Shelley, perhaps. Brenda Song is a little more mid-age, and Kiernan Shipka is freshly 19, the wide-eyed, you know, fresh off the bus, like, I'm here to dance, dancer. And so it takes place in Las Vegas, but you kind of get these, like, beautiful meandering shots through the ruins of Las Vegas, as it is, like, a great metaphor for, like, the ruins of Shelley's life. She tried to be a mother, she's a single woman, she bet on herself completely, bet it all on herself, and where better place to gamble than Las Vegas, I guess. But she has this philosophy of really believing in yourself and your art, no matter what the consequences are. If that's what you're passionate about, you will be successful and you will be fulfilled. However, she's kind of lived her life as the showgirl sort of hand to mouth, and really had to struggle, and has given up lots of major milestones in her life in favor of her truest pursuit and her one true passion. And the thing that makes her is being a showgirl. I get a little choked up thinking about it. It was deeply moving, the portrayals by the gals and the entire ensemble cast, Jamie Lee Curtis, Kiernan Shipka, Brenda Song. There was a real love and family aspect to it. Also, Dave Bautista was phenomenal in this. He's steady as, you know, rock steady as their producer, Eddie. And he's got a real quiet side to him. He's sort of just used to being in the wings and watching and orchestrating, but he has a real tender hand with it, even though he's just this giant amongst all these beautiful women. Shelley gets her moment in the limelight, and it's absolutely beautiful. I hope that everyone gets a chance to see this, and I hope that everyone takes away that philosophy of always believing in yourself. But it could end up being a solitary existence. You just kind of have to be okay with that, I guess.
Yeah, I don't think this one has a distributor either. This seems like a Neon movie.
I hope it is. I hope somebody picks it up. I want to own it on DVD. I want the book catalog of all the shots. I want feathers and glitter. I want everything. This was perfect. It really broke my heart and put it back together again.
Yeah. Andrew.
Yeah, I want to talk about, it's hard to pick, but I would like to talk about Rumors, the new movie by Guy Maddin, working with two other directors, Gowan Johnson and Evan Johnson, who he's worked with before on a couple of different projects, including The Green Fog, his like gonzo recreation of Vertigo using only footage from other movies also shot in San Francisco. But this is a much more of like a straightforward narrative film than I think he is usually known for. It's kind of a political farce, in a way that reminded me a little bit of the early work of, or I guess not the early work, but some of the recent work of Armando Iannucci, I was reminded of Death of Stalin quite a bit watching this movie. But it is set at the G7 summit, where, you know, world leaders from the seven different countries get together to do something. The lack of substance to what they do is kind of part of the comedy of the movie. There's some sort of crisis going on in the world that is never fully explained, partially because you're not really sure when you are in American history, but also because these politicians refuse to, like, put words to the problems the world is facing. You know, they can't, if they were to talk about the crisis, they would have to frame it in a way that showed that would show some sort of deference to one side or the other of the crisis. I was thinking a lot about, you know, the ongoing genocide in Gaza and how, like, very few world leaders had actually called that a genocide. And that could very well be one of the things that these politicians are there to talk about. But they're just there to draft up some sort of a statement, some sort of a, you know, a statement that is not going to actually do anything but, you know, attempts to assuage the world that, like, you're in good hands, everything is fine. But these characters kind of cannot even write the statement. You know, partially for the same reason I already named, that, like, nobody wants to, like, take a stance on one issue or another. We just want to kind of, like, throw like political jargon and you know, these nothing aphorisms out into the wind. So that we don't have to commit to actually, taking steps to make the world better, or taking risks to make the world better, or whatever else. Really, really funny movie. Probably the hardest I have laughed throughout a movie at the festival. And I also love the kind of genre bendy stuff that this movie is doing as well. Kind of similar to what we were talking about with Cloud and Nora earlier. This one kind of fuses this political satire with kind of a cosmic horror dimension as the movie goes on. There's like an apocalypse that's breaking out as these leaders are having the G7, and part of the humor is seeing them be completely inept at how to handle it, like if it's just them in real time. And I don't want to spoil too much about what all that entails. But you will probably see in the marketing images of this movie an image of a giant brain sitting in the woods, which is one, like, amazing image that this movie provides. But would really recommend it. Super good time. Very sharp satire. Yeah, that's my pick.
Awesome. Well, be sure to check out. We have some thoughts on Instagram. We have some thoughts on Twitter of various movies that we saw at the festival. We will probably have some reviews coming out on the site soon about them, but another successful TIFF in the books.
Mm-hmm.
Festival. Yeah, absolutely. We're gonna take a quick break, and then we will be back talking broadcast news after this. Of episode 483 of Cinematary. In this part, we're going to be continuing our journalism and film series with 1987's broadcast news. But we've shifted over from Toronto, and I got Reed and Nadine here. Nadine, it's been a minute. Welcome back to Cinematary.
It has. I don't, you know, it's like some people may not even know me. I know the long time heads will, you know, not quite an original founding member, but
yeah, close enough.
I kind of view it that way. I'm an OG at the very least.
100%.
And it's good to be back. You know, it's good to be I feel like I went through, and I still kind of am, but like went through the woods a little bit with my terms of like enjoyment of movies and you know, one of those things. And also I've just like really had to, I think this is just true of a lot of us, I've just like really had to like rebuild my attention span. So I have been taking, like, you know, I do not watch movies quite as much as I did in the heyday of being a part of Cinema Terry. Wow, can't even say the name anymore. But it's like kind of nice. In some ways, it's kind of nice because I just feel like I am a little bit more like, I don't know, a little more, I don't know what word I'm looking for, but just like, you know, it's just like a rare occasion to watch a movie. So it's like my thoughts are a little more zeroed in.
We're getting close to, you know, 10 years of Cinematary. You know, it was a lot of years we were like drinking beer. Now we're in our glass of wine age of Cinematary.
Yeah,
we're much more refined.
Yeah. And, you know, it's like you kind of, I think sometimes it can be easy to like get your, when you're talking about movies, discussing them, and then like sort of your watching of them gets bound up in that.
Yeah.
Where it's kind of like separating those strands, which I feel like is kind of, you know, not entirely unrelated to this movie of like,
yeah,
personal relationship, your conviction and your belief in what you're doing versus like doing it. I don't know.
No, 100%.
Anyways, I'm rambling, but good to be back.
Yeah, we got Reed's back because he's like lurking in the, there's a Shyamalan series and he's like lurking in the woods in the background. So he's like having to slowly come back in before diving headfirst into that series.
Yeah, I mean, I think I may have made an appearance at least once every 6 months for the past several years.
But this time, you're just like, oh, well, what are they doing?
I know.
I think I was the same way with like signing up for almost everything in the Shyamalan series.
Yeah, bat signal just went up and
yeah,
I have to be there.
All right, well, let's jump into the broadcast news. Written and directed by James L. Brooks, stars Holly Hunter, William Hurt, and Albert Brooks. A highly strung news producer finds herself strangely attracted to a vapid anchorman, even though she loathes everything he personifies. To make matters worse, her best friend, a talented but not particularly telegenic news reporter, is secretly in love with her. Broadcast news began as an idea to portray a romantic comedy with a quote new kind of heroine. Although his hit television series The Mary Tyler Moore Show and its spinoff Lou Grant both took place in newsrooms, Brooks did not intend to revisit the setting for a film until he attended the Democratic National Convention in July 1984. Noting how much broadcast news had changed since his time working as a copy boy in the 1960s, he decided to use the workplace as a backdrop for a love triangle between three ambitious individuals. During the convention, he met CBS news producer Susan Zirinsky, who acted as a technical advisor throughout the next year and a half of research. Zirinsky was eventually named associate producer. Although several sources claim that Jan Craig was based on Zirinsky, both she and Brooks asserted that the character was a composite of several different women working in broadcast journalism at the time. Brooks wrote the role of Aaron specifically for his longtime friend Albert Brooks, but struggled to find the right actress to play Jane. Newsweek indicated that Deborah Winger, Sigourney Weaver, Diane Wiest, Jessica Lange, Elizabeth Perkins, and Mary Beth Hurt were among those considered before he agreed to audition Holly Hunter, unknown to the director at the time, just 2 days before the start of production. Winger originally had the role, but became pregnant prior to filming, which opened the door for Hunter. In 1987, the New York Times said Mr. Brooks' screenplay overstates matters both at the beginning of the film and at the end, with a prologue that strains to be cute and an epilogue that is unnecessary. In between, however, the movie is a sarcastic and carefully detailed picture of a world Mr. Brooks finds fascinating and also a little scary. The LA Times in 1987 said broadcast news seems to suggest that TV news is a constant tug of war between hordes of Grunnicks and a few stubbornly uncompromising Altmans, with a vacuum in the center. Yet Grunnick and Altman are almost too obvious and predictable as the opposite poles in the story, nor is Grunnick the prototype for new network anchors. There's room to debate the relative merits of Dan Rather, Tom Brokaw, and Peter Jennings as journalists, but they are journalists, each having paid his dues in some fashion, unlike Grunnick, who is merely a newsreader and a marionette. And Roger Ebert in 1987 said, "Broadcast news has a lot of interesting things to say about television, but a thing it does best is look into a certain kind of personality and a certain kind of relationship. Like Tears of Endearment, the previous film by James L. Brooks, it does not see relationships as a matter of meeting someone you like and falling in love. Brooks, almost alone among major Hollywood filmmakers, knows that some people have higher priorities than love and deeper fears." On that note, let's talk a little bit about broadcast news. I think I'd seen this at least once prior to this. We talked a little bit about it before we started recording. But this one hits a little bit. That was like a couple years out of college. It was kind of like, hey, broadcast news, it's one of the ones to watch. And I caught it then. And I liked it, but I felt like I was a little bit at arm's length from really what it's trying, the messaging it's trying to get across. That hit tenfold this time. A lot more life lived, a lot more like understanding of the dynamics going on in the room in this one. And I agree. We can talk about it a little bit later. I agree a bit with the LA Times on the prologue and the epilogue kind of feeling a little out of place for the overall story. But I felt like this thing's just a banger. Like it's super sharp. It's really funny. Perfectly cast. Like it's like that list of actresses for the lead role, like Holly Hunter is just so perfect in this. She's so incredible in this. Like I think a lot of people point to like the scene where she's like making herself cry in the room as like, you know, I've seen that like shared a lot, and maybe even people who have never seen this movie are like familiar with just that sequence. But outside of that, she's just like across the board great. This second viewing, I'm really high on broadcast news. But Reed, what did you think?
Yeah, I think it was my second or third time watching it. Really enjoyed it again. And I think honestly, like I had completely forgotten about the prologue and the epilogue when rewatching it again. I was just the middle of the main section of the movie is all that really stuck in my brain. But watching it back, I think those scenes are kind of funny because they're really like schmaltzy and like nostalgic and like very, very strange compared to a lot of the tone of the rest of the movie. But I feel like it's also somewhat what the movie is about, is how it's reminding you that like that middle section, that's what's actually important. Like it's these weird things that happen to these kids, or like these moments in these kids' lives that are supposed to be huge, like monumental chapters of their life is what we get at the beginning. And the end is like this cute little bow. Like he's giving a speech. They're seeing his kid. They have fiancés or wives, or they're seeing someone, or like they're getting the promotion. Whereas in reality, like their life is contained in like the actual movie, the meat of it, the complex and like strange relationships they've built and the dynamics they have within this like small span of time. Which like, I think it's funny, like just, I'm only saying this, I guess, because you mentioned that in that review. I think it really did actually stick out to me this time that the beginning and the end kind of are almost just like signposts to like what the movie's actually trying to say is important.
Yeah.
Here, I don't know, we can dig into that more, but I'm anxious to hear what you thought, Nadine.
Yeah, it was also a rewatch for me, and I feel like it's one of those movies that, at least in my experience, I feel like I was taught certain like scenes like in screenwriting classes, or like given kind of examples of just like, this is like, you know, good writing. And I feel like it's so interesting to me kind of hearing about some of the casting, and just the fact that like, you know, Holly Hunter, like that there are many other contenders for the role, because it just feels so like molded to her. And one of the things that I thought was so interesting kind of rewatching it was just thinking about like her accent and the fact that they like, you know, they say that she's from Atlanta, but one of the things that's odd to me about that prologue scene is that her father like does not have an accent at all. And it's like, it's almost like they take like kind of the approach of like Arnold Schwarzenegger being cast in like as an American, where it's just kind of like, you know, every like you are sort of curious about how this person ended up in this milieu, but like we're not really going to address it at all. And so it's just kind of like becomes very obvious to me, and just like hearing about the casting, and it's like, oh, they gave like that child an accent because the role was just so kind of like particular to, I mean, obviously like it could have, I could see Deborah Winger or other stars like having the kind of screwball professional woman energy that she has, but there's just something that's so unique to me about it, about the fact that she's like this Southern woman and they don't really make a point out of that. Like they don't really, you know, there's no story about her, there's no plot line about her being like judged for her accent. There's no like, she didn't pull herself up by her bootstraps, she's not a fish out of water. It's just like they don't, it's just there. And and that's just like, you know, I feel like a lot of the movie kind of exists. It is a very, like, I totally understand why it has that kind of, and James L. Brooks in general has that kind of, like, screenwriterly reputation, but it's such a movie where it really exists in these, like, small details, I think, whether it's, like, Holly Hunter's accent or, like, the way that she, like, unplugs the phone every time she needs to cry. And there's just, like, a very lived in attention to detail. And it's, I think I agree about the sort of the kind of strangeness of the prologue and the epilogue, but I also kind of, at least with the prologue, I understand sort of the narrative function of like, you are just sort of, except for Tom, because he's like introduced into the narrative, but the Albert Brooks Holly Hunter relationship is just like,
yeah,
you know, it's sort of just communicating that like these people have been this way before you ever met them. And so the relationship, it doesn't, you know, we know their coworkers, we know their friends, but we don't know, in similar way, like with her accent, we don't, we just know these like broad gestures of like they met each other at some point in working together and really bonded with each other. And now we're just like thrust into this really particular dynamic that's very well established, and in the performances too, of like, it's not, it's a relationship that like you're supposed to feel and not one where it's told to you. And I think that's what really makes this Broadcast News kind of has a lot of staying power, is just because of that relationship.
It also has a, it also has a great joke in the prologue. I'm thinking about it now with at least the Tom character, where he like has bad grades. It seems like he's not really going to improve much. His dad's just kind of like, well, try your best, I guess. He's like, oh, I guess so. You know, I don't know what I'll be able to do. And then it has like future news anchor on like the, on the screen, like immediately after, which is like a nice little like visual gag kind of there. But yeah, I agree totally on like it creating this very lived in environment. Like, it is a movie of like super tiny details, the unplugging of the phone, like that ritual, like there's something really like nice about, you can just tell that she has this ritual from I'm going to unplug the phone, I'm going to cry, I'm going to clean myself up and then plug in the phone. Like there's just like, it gives you the idea that this is not something that she's like, I'm just going to do this once. It's like, no, this is like, this is a part of the day. Like this is something that she's doing frequently. And it has, you know, just kind of a lot of those details where, yeah, you don't need to spend a lot of time kind of going like, this is this person. Like because it feels so lived in, you immediately catch up to the characters within like 5 minutes of the movie. Like you don't need to sit there and go, this is the Albert Brooks character, this is the Holly Hunter. You know, you kind of get a sense of everybody very, very quickly. Even when you meet Tom, when she's speaking at like the conference and he's kind of there, he has this woman kind of on his arm to a degree, but he's locked into what she's saying, and just the way he kind of goes and is talking to her, where, you know, he's somebody who I think he you can tell whenever he goes up to a woman, he feels like he very much is like in control and is like the dominant figure in every conversation. And when that's what kind of draws him into Holly Hunter, because Jan is very like, she dominates, like regardless of like, it's less that she's just like a dominating presence, it's more just, you know, it's like the comment that the news boss makes later in the movie. Like, she kind of comes in as like, I'm the smartest person in the room. I know the answers. And for good or for bad, that kind of puts her like in a conversation she's going to probably lead. But yeah, I think a lot, you know, looking through those actresses, those are all really good actresses, but like Holly Hunter, like you get some pathos, you get some like empathy out of this character, even though she can be a lot. And I feel like that's a testament to Holly Hunter.
There's a really great moment I noticed watching this time where they're at the party pretty like 2/3 of the way through the movie or so. And the one woman, or maybe about halfway, and the one woman, I think Jennifer asks, mm-hmm. Jane, if she could start talking to Tom. Mm-hmm. And then she is like conflicted, doesn't really know, hasn't like kind of sorted out her own feelings on the issue yet, and is even surprised that she's conflicted. But then she re-enters the party, and to avoid walking right past him, she like glues herself to the wall and like just like shimmies along the wall, like trying to like not knock anyone else over. And like Tom's watching her do it, and she's like more noticeable because of that. And I thought that was, I don't know, it is like the little details like that.
I like the conversation also, because like she's going through like she's thinking through out loud all of her feelings and like processing this thing. And the other woman is just like, I just need a yes or no.
She's like, I wasn't going to do anything tonight. I just wanted to yes or no.
Yeah. Holly Hunter's like, you know, well, actually, you know, she's like sitting there like processing through everything. And the woman's just like, I just need the yes or no. Like it's a one or two question.
I feel like that's one of the things that's like really stands out about broadcast news too, is just like, she is not like, she is an endearing character, but not really a like conventionally likable character, at least in terms of like a female protagonist, and especially in terms of like a movie that is ostensibly a romantic comedy. But it's also it's just really fascinating to me, because it's like, it is romantic, but it is not, it is a different kind of romantic
comedy,
you know, of just like, it is not like, it is about the will they, won't they, but it's not, you know,
there's no meat cue.
It's totally within these like kind of parameters that I just feel like sort of break the mold of the genre a little bit. And and I mean, I feel like James L. Brooks is kind of interesting, because he is, you know, like a very comic filmmaker, but very dramatic at the same time, and kind of writing a strange line, which I feel like this movie is kind of partly about that, of like, you know, using this conflict in sort of the ethics of journalism. I feel like kind of you can extrapolate that to like probably a kind of dilemma, you know, of being a filmmaker, of like sort of the classic art versus commerce, kind of like integrity versus selling out. And just something that I kind of remember that just popped in my head, of like, there's a line in the movie where Albert Brooks talks about how he's like focus grouped, his face is like focus group. And that just brought to mind of like, because there's the infamous James L. Brooks musical from the 90s, I'll Do Anything, which had William Hurt in it, which had all these like, was originally like a musical and had all these like Prince songs in it. And then James L. Brooks by that point had gotten so obsessed with focus testing that he like ended up kind of destroying his own movie, because he cut out all of the musical numbers, all of the things that like made it distinct. So like the original work print edit of I'll Do Anything is this kind of like holy grail, because of exactly, I think, what you kind of start to see developing in this movie, of James L. Brooks being like, I'm this like TV guy, but I'm also this, you know, I've done Terms of Endearment, I'm also this Oscar guy, like, where do I fit in? And I feel like that's just like, romantic comedies are usually just about the relationships. It's not that like characters are representative of like specific ideals. And I think that's like part of what makes this a little bit different, is every character kind of stands for something. And there's like a, you know, a message to be taken beyond just like, and then also too, of like, what part of, I think what makes the prologue so odd is like, there is no will they, won't they, nobody ends up together.
Yeah.
Like they all end up where they're supposed to end up, but it's just like, it's such a, you know, it kind of throws you for a loop or anything. Cause even until those final moments, you're sort of expecting like, oh, you know, she's
with Albert.
Right. She's turned on Tom and Albert gave her the info that made her see who he really was, but they're not together. And also he's still like, that's kind of crazy too, that like nobody, like Tom is like still this like acclaimed journalist, and it's like that would have been, there would have been a scandal. I don't know about that. Like,
oh yeah, you're just like, I guess she held on to that one, so he owes you that.
Especially, I'd also forgotten too, I misremembered totally of like, I thought he was like, it was just some like, you know, political news segment that he had like faked himself crying. I totally forgot that it was this segment about date rape, which just kind of like gives this like other kind of level of, I do, that is kind of something that I think is kind of odd about this movie, is like Tom is kind of cast, there's not really like a villain either, you know, it's like Tom is kind of the bad guy, and there is this way that he is like actually the devil, but there's still room for the devil, you know, like,
well, and at the same time,
cast him out.
Yeah, at the same time, Albert Brooks's Aaron says some like truly unforgivable shit to Jane, and then she just kind of moves on, you know, like, that's just how their relationship is. But it's brutal, some of the lines he has
about like being fat and single. Like, I'm just like, what the hell, bro?
Or when he like, or when he like shouts at her in his house when she's gonna go to meet Tom, That's like, honestly, I was gonna say, like, Albert Brooks is really the only person who can handle this role, because like, yeah, like he says some awful stuff, like just over the course of the movie, he says awful stuff, but like he's able to sell it because it's Albert Brooks, and he's because he's even more, you know, I was like thinking about this while you were talking about the romantic comedies, and you know, this very much exists, I feel like, in the same sphere as like an Annie Hall or a When Harry Met Sally, like in terms of like these, they're rom-coms, but there's like a little bit more teeth to them, and they're a little bit more smarter with their relationships. But I was, you know, it's just mentioning Annie Hall, it's like, yeah, this is kind of or even the Billy Crystal character in When Harry Met Sally, like Albert Brooks is kind of the Woody Allen character, if you like, you had to place a Woody Allen character in there. But like, there's something about just Albert Brooks in general as an actor who I feel like can kind of sell, he can say that kind of stuff, and it lands differently if it was Albert Brooks saying it compared to like if it was like Woody Allen kind of playing this similar role. I feel like Albert Brooks is able, I don't even know like how to describe it, he just is able to kind of sell some like evil shit, saying some evil shit, but in a way you don't like necessarily absolutely hate him by the end of it.
You can still feel like, and I think that's something of like, even though the opening flashback kind of prologue or origin story is like tonally very different from the rest of the movie, it also like you can, it's really interesting, because I feel like that's something that in what you were saying about Albert Brooks is that I think part of what that is that he still has this very like childlike essence, where you can just still see him as this like little boy trying to fit in, and like the kind of you know, when you feel like his like desperation when he sort of finds out that he's probably like not gonna survive this regime change and the layoffs and everything, where just like you feel, even though he's been this pretty selfish, toxic character, you still like, you know, you want to root for him, but you also root for William Hurt too. And I think you can also, I think that's something that's kind of interesting about his performance too, is you still really feel this like childlike essence, like even just every like romantic, like whether it's like when he sleeps with the other female coworker and she sees the like the she makes a joke about like the shadow of his dick on the wall, and he's just like so like playful about it, and then also when he sees Holly Hunter at the correspondence dinner and he's like, ooh, like Cupid's bow, like he mimes like, you know, his heart really being struck and taken aback. And so it's another interesting, I mean, these are all like, that's the, I think the interesting thing about it too is these are all people, like all characters who are very flawed and who have very unsympathetic moments, and who are also all people where it's like, if you thought about meeting that person in real life, like probably a lot of us wouldn't get along with
anyone. Yeah, it wouldn't be very pleasant.
But somehow we still feel something for all of them.
Yeah. And that kind of is a good, I think, segue into really the second part of what to talk about with this movie is that, like, this is, it's a love triangle. It's a romance, you know, romantic comedy in that way. But it's also three people who in different ways love their job. Like, even though he quits, like Albert Brooks's character, you know, Albert loves his, like, loves being a journalist. And you assume, like, in the epilogue that they mentioned something about Portland, like he's doing journalism probably or something along those lines somewhere else. But they're all, like, I think, passionate about their work mm-hmm. and, like, want to do a good job. But you have that tied with, you have the news director and, like, the, oh, we're going to be, you know, doing all these millions of dollars into cuts and having to completely chop up this Washington bureau for this, you know, for this TV station. And it's kind of just like it's the realities of journalism. Even today, like, that was something while watching it, it kind of in a way comforted me, because I'm like, this is coming out in like 87. It's the same thing we deal with on a daily basis today, where it's just like, there's so many people who I work with and I know who just, like, love what they do and love telling stories and love being able to, like, do that for their community. But then corporate interest and that money just coming up from hedge funds completely just, like, chops everything down. And you're just like, how are you able to kind of keep that love going when you continue to get pummeled down on the ground?
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like that kind of becomes the second act of this movie.
Yeah, totally. I think it's something where it's just it uses the workplace is not really the source of, like, I feel like in so many, like, workplace, you know, sort of sets,
mm-hmm.
romantic comedies, it's like that's kind of the driver of hijinks and, like, oh my, you know, the awkwardness or whatever. And they're all able to, like, still work together and, like, coexist. And, you know, there's obviously gags kind of, like, about, like, you know, trying to avoid people or whatever, but I think it's like you can tell that it comes from that kind of, like, personal, you know, compared to like because I think that I don't think he directed it, but I think, like, around this time James L. Brooks also produced the movie Perfect with John Travolta and Jamie Lee Curtis, which is, like, romance, you know, like, kind of erotic romance, like, set in a gym.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I feel like there was kind of this trend about the sort of, like, workplace romance, but it's like, it's very much invested in, like, the, like you were saying, the kind of relationships of these characters to their work. And I think that's, like, what makes the Albert Brooks Holly Hunter relationship so interesting is just, like, you can tell that, like, the work is their relationship, and, like, that's the thing that is, like, their intercourse. And I think one of the scenes in the movie is when Tom is doing the anchoring. That's and you know, Sheaf is giving him the directions, and you just feel, and there's that amazing kind of use of, like, the split diopter shots over the shoulders and kind of, like, getting everyone's perspective in. But it also makes it feel like when he says, like, you were inside my head, like, the way that it is framed and shot and everything really does make you get that feeling of, like, this voice, this, like, she is inside his head. And it's kind of like, I feel like the movie, you know, especially with the ending where it's like there's a place for everybody in journalism, but also emotionally they can't coexist with each other. But I think that's kind of the interesting thing that it's sort of lands on a little bit, is it's like there is a purpose for the puppet. There is a purpose for the pretty mouthpiece. And so it's kind of like this weird, even though nobody actually ends up together romantically, it is still this kind of, like, you know, Lubitsch-esque threesome a little bit, because they're all still, they still have a relation. You know, they're not an actual thruple, but they still, the movie ends with them all, you know, like sitting on a park bench, you know, with a child. And it's like they all did kind of have a child together in a sense, you know, that's their work.
Well, it's you describe that scene, which also is like a very sexually charged scene. Like that's pretty much the movie's sex scene is is him doing that first broadcast and Holly Hunter just feed. But then feeding into her is Albert Brooks with like little tidbits to then give him. Like it's all just like it is like this. It's pretty much like it's pretty much this three way sex scene between the three of them, and in the only language that they seem to be able to kind of at least work together on, and that's just through news. And like that is easily like the best part of the movie, because it's just so, it's all of them clicking at the same time, and you're just like, yeah, like now you see it to a degree.
And I think you
I was just gonna say you also get the sense that like with the scene included, you get the sense that Albert Brooks and Aaron and Jane would have just continued their relationship exactly as it was, potentially forever, if Tom had never showed up and just kind of like fucked everything up. Because like y'all are saying, to them, the work is the relationship. Like, sure, they might, like Aaron like might want a little bit more from Jane. Like he might like yearn for that deep down, but he doesn't care. He just wants what they have when they go into work together. And then Tom shows up, and then Jane realizes she wants something more alongside the news as well. Yeah. She's like actually sexually attracted to him. And that just like absolutely ruins Aaron's world.
Well, and going back to Nadine's point about the character, about Aaron as a character, like he's just so he's like a child still. And so like, so he's kind of looking at it. Oh, well, we work together like that. That's the relationship. He has no concept of, I mean, we talked about like the stuff he says out in other contexts, like, yeah, because like outside of the work context where they're talking to each other as just human to human, he seems to really struggle with. And he says stuff that you're just like, what the hell are you doing, man? And so like the thing I think that gets him the most about Tom, that I think at the end eventually gets him to a place where it's like, you're an adult now, is like he just couldn't understand why she'd be attracted to him. It's like, yeah, because like it's two adults who are attracted to each other. Like she's not attracted to you, not because of anything else, but then that you're just pretty much a child who is like kind of looking for her to her to like reassure you, and like nobody wants that.
I think it's also like really you know, it's not literally about this, but it's like my experience in journalism, if you call it that, is, you know, it's just like on the page, on the screen, the written word. But I feel like it does. I really like that it shows that like this is like, you know, like when she like basically writes the story for Tom like early on, and Albert Brooks is like, oh, like, you know, I thought you were above this, blah blah, but it's like, you know, that is like, I think one of the, and I've never really been in an editorial position, I've just been kind of on the writer side of it, but that is one of the things that is so fascinating to me about it, and just kind of is just like the way that it is like nobody is ever, you know, you might have just your name on something, but if you're a writer, if you're a journalist, whether broadcast or print or radio, it, you know, I still think, I guess, but it's like there's always that kind of balance of like the words, the meat, the writing, and kind of the presentation. And it really is like sometimes when I feel like the best versions of those relationships, it really is like this kind of like having somebody inside your head, you know, having somebody who's like able to sort of predict what you're going to say, or is able to see what you're trying to say better than you can. Where it is kind of this like knowledge, like this kind of self-knowledge. It's like not like I'm trying to say that like I've ever like had any of this kind of charged relationship with an editor or anything like that, but it's just like this kind of I don't know, I think it makes you kind of aware of yourself in a different way. And I think that's kind of one of the interesting differences between Tom and Aaron is that, like, Tom kind of sees for better, or I mean, I guess it's kind of, it comes down to like idealist versus kind of cynic. But in some ways it's like the movie is not, I feel like those framings aren't right, because like we've been saying, like the movie does not really like cast judgment on one route. And, you know, there's this kind of like, it's Tom kind of lets himself be used. He sees himself as this like cog in a machine and this kind of imperfect element, whereas mm-hmm. Aaron is like, tries to do everything himself and thinks he can do everything himself. And it's like, you know, he has to learn the hard way with like sweat dripping down his face that like he doesn't know everything. But yeah, I don't know where I was.
No, you're right though. Speaking as, I guess, the editor within the group, like it's kind of a tough role, especially if you come from it like where you've been writing and like you have your own distinct voice. Like the job is not to go in there and be like, well, this doesn't sound like me, I would have done it this way. I say that all the time, where I'll read something and be like, I would have done this differently, but that's not your job to do that. You know, you don't rewrite it that way. You a good editor recognizes the strengths of the writer and like it finds the way, how can we best accentuate that more in order to make a better piece. And I think that that's what's interesting, this past watch of this movie is like that's the kind of two dynamics, is like the Tom dynamic is vilified from them at the top, where it's just like, oh, like he's just an egotist, like he's coming in, it's all entertainment, is news, et cetera, et cetera. But he also, like, to your point, Nadine, he's somebody who is much more open to collaboration, because he's just like, I don't know everything, so mm-hmm. I'm more than happy to let you kind of mold what I do best and make that a better piece. While Aaron is more, he's in the same mold as Jane, where it's just like, I know I'm the smartest person in the room, I know everything. And that might be true, but that might, you know, your way of doing it may not always be the best way to present this story. And so like, that's the kind of thing that, you know, that Aaron learns in a very humbling and also incredibly funny experience when he's mm-hmm. finally anchoring, which just to like say, like, it's a very funny sequence. But he learns, it's like, yeah, like I think that's where he kind of learns to grow up, because he's like, yeah, I can't do that. And I think the lesson to take away is that, again, like we've been saying, like neither way is right. It's kind of trying to find and strike that balance. And that's where the growing up happens. That's, again, to bookend it a little bit, that between the prologue and the epilogue, the finding the way to kind of meet that middle section is where it's where it's at. That's where you find mm-hmm. the best work.
It's all in relationships, you know.
Mm-hmm. It's all in relationships. Yeah. Can we talk real briefly? He has a presence lingering over this, but Jack Nicholson in this movie as like the lead anchor. You see him like a couple times. You see him as like this, he's this kind of look to approval. There's the sequence where, you know, Albert Brooks gets all excited because he like, he thinks he smiled after his story. Mm-hmm. He calls and like compliments Jane on her work and tells her to, you know, kind of take the credit. It's not, you know, you don't have to like funnel somebody into that credit. And then you have the scene like late in the movie where you finally see him in person, and he shows up at the newsroom on the day of the massive layoffs and is just kind of there leering over everything as this kind of, it's a weird, like, it's this like weird, like everybody, like all these people are going to get laid off, so let's bring a celebrity in to a degree, because he's just kind of there and people are like kind of at awe at his feet. What did y'all make of Jack Nicholson's like brief appearances in this to kind of, as a kind of lingering force? That's not, it's not the, you know, it's not the bosses, it's not the people in the top floor, but he ain't that far off.
I mean, I think he's effective in the sense that he does actually seem like an 80s era news anchor. Like he, mm-hmm. I don't know, at least like in the clips you get it, that it all feels very, very real. But I find that scene actually, the layoff, like right leading into the layoff scene, mm-hmm. because I know it's leading to that as well, I find it pretty funny in this, like, in this watch, just because it's so strange that he's there. Like, it makes no sense to me, like you're saying, because he's not doing the layoffs. He's just there for morale, but he's not really chatting it up. He's off, like, by himself at one point, just, like, pacing. And then he's not sticking around for, like, the chaos afterwards. And so it's... I found it strange, but he is effective, and I think it's also more... it's interesting to then see towards the end of the movie when Tom's doing his speech, he's implying that he's taking over that role as, like, the lead anchor, as Jack Nicholson's character is stepping down. And I think a lot of it is just to see him as, like, a placeholder. Like, this is the next 30 years of the station is this guy, is this face now. And I think with Jack Nicholson there, you have kind of a face you can put a face to that era, essentially, with Tom coming in.
I love, like, when he meets Tom and they just, like, linger on the handshake.
Yeah, yeah.
For, like, a minute.
Do a close-up and linger. You know,
in this very, like, it's like the Predator hand, like, handshake, but, like, really awkward, you know. And it's interesting because it's kind of, like, too, also, it's sort of, like, the devil is, like, already here. You know, it's like, you know, and two, I think it's kind of interesting that they sort of, like, intimate that because the Joan Cusack character, you know, like, comes up to him at one point, and the sort of, to me, the subtext is that of that is that they had, you know, some kind of relationship, and he's, like, glad that she is being fired so he doesn't have to deal with the aftermath of that. Which, just, like, I feel like that's kind of another, you know, again, it's not, like, a focal point, but that's just kind of another, like, touch of reality, because it's just, like, you know, it's like that you know, is a real thing. And so it's just kind of seeing that, like, just acknowledgement of, like, the way that people kind of use their, like, positions of power and influence. You know, it's like, it's like, on the one hand, like, I feel like the movie is kind of like it's just for, you know, I was sort of saying earlier of, like, there's kind of, like, the idealism versus cynicism sort of represented in Aaron and Tom. But the movie itself is kind of like, you know, it believes in what these people are doing, and that this is, like, an important task. But it's also just very, like, you know, in those subtle ways of kind of like, yeah, this is, there are, things are not always above the board, even though we're trying to tell the real news, the real stories.
Yeah. I mean, I feel like it seems like James L. Brooks and Jack Nicholson are pretty tight. You know, I could see why, like, he got that role, but, like, you did, like, he's perfect for that. You need somebody that can kind of, that has, like, a command outside of just, like, whatever the character, because really, like, you don't know, it's not I forgot what his name is, like, Bob Rorsch or
something, like,
what,
that
it doesn't matter, it's Jack Nicholson, like, and you, like, kind of need somebody like that. You need somebody who, it's just the actor is there. And I think that, like, he's kind of, I don't know who else you would, like, you could contend with. I think of I'm thinking of, like, the other TV broadcast. Was it the Morning Glory, where they have Harrison Ford. He, like, somebody like Harrison Ford wouldn't work in 1987 because he was still kind of new. But you need somebody like that just to, like, kind of just be a movie star in that role. Mm-hmm. And, like, that's all he needs to do. And I think he, like, nails that. Any final thoughts on broadcast news as we wrap up? I think it holds up.
Yeah.
Two thumbs up.
All the news that's fit to print.
Yeah. What I love the one line, what is it? When Albert Brooks is interviewing the guy and he's like, fuck, 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 fuck. Can you run that? And he goes, only if it's a slow news day. I like that. The other line I love from this movie that I didn't notice till this time was when Joan Cusack gets laid off and she's, like, hugging Holly Hunter to leave. And she goes, she goes, Jane, I don't know if you knew this, but except socially, you're my role model.
This is incredible.
I just love, except socially, you're my role model. But yeah, broadcast news. Good one. All right. Well, that'll wrap up this episode of Cinematary. You can find us on Twitter and Instagram at handle at Cinematary. For those listening, it'll be a little late, but we'll probably have some recaps of the Toronto Film Festival on both of those platforms to check out. If you'd like to support the show, patreon.com/cinematary. Thank you so much to our patrons, Cam, Ron Hayes, Tanner Huskins, Teresa Marsathi, and Tyler Chandler. We appreciate you supporting the show. We're going to be wrapping up our journalism and film series with 2015 Spotlight on the next episode. So it's, you know, we talked about all the President's Men in the previous episode. I think this is going to be kind of a nice little tandem as we look at how both of those are portrayed decades apart. And we will have, I believe, two, but I'm hoping to have two journalists from the Charlotte Observer with me who are younger, who like look up to this movie a lot. Mm-hmm. So this is very much like the more recent version of like all the President's Men in terms of inspiring journalists. So until then, thanks y'all for listening. And we'll see you next episode.